joyful good morning to you.
Good morning.
You all are awake, right? Let's try that again. A joyful good morning to you.
Good morning.
I know it's a little foggy out there. I do want to welcome everyone to the service of worship here at First Presbyterian Church of Mount Dora on this third Sunday of Advent. And I'm especially welcome my lovely assistant here this morning, who's going to be helping me with the early part of the service. I've been having some trouble with my eyes. She's going to read a scripture. But I'm glad that you're here with us as well in the sanctuary, as well as those online. I hope the service will be a blessing to us all. The flowers that are here in the sanctuary, they were here last week as well, are from John and Liz Welch in celebration of their first anniversary. They were married here a year ago in the sanctuary. And the flowers held up so well that they were also utilized this last Friday for yet another beautiful wedding that we had. And that was Emmy Lowe's wedding. She, of course, is the daughter of John Lowe, and she grew up in the church here. And she was a little girl coming forward and sitting on the steps for the children's message once upon a time. And she wanted to get married in her home church. And it was a delight for me to be able to do that. Many of you saw it, I think, and I understand there were 500 people that have seen it online. So we'll be talking about it a little bit later on. We had a very nice turnout yesterday for the Christmas Carol sing-along, sponsored by the men's group. But it wasn't just for the men, it was for ladies in the church, folks to bring your spouse or your significant other. That's the event several years ago when I put my foot in my mouth yet again, and I said, men, you can bring your wives, and then realizing some are married to someone, or your girlfriend. And people laughed. Bring your wife or your girlfriend. Then I realized what I said. But make sure you don't bring your wife and your girlfriend. This coming week, we have our Christmas concert. And that will be at 7 o'clock. Is that right, Randy?
Yes.
7 o'clock on Tuesday night. That will be both here in the sanctuary and online as well. Wednesday, there's a special session meeting at 4 o'clock. The deadline for ordering poinsettias is this Thursday. And we have several other giving opportunities for you. The Christmas joy offering pamphlet is in your bulletin, as well as offering an envelope for that. I was asked how you give. You just make your check out to the church like you always do, and then just put on the memo lines for Christmas joy offering. Our alternative Christmas market is ongoing. We had it last Sunday, and we're continuing to receive those. There are lots of regular good things going on all the time every week. Sunday school, men's Bible, prayer group, and so forth. So avail yourself of those wonderful opportunities to grow in faith. Our prayer concerns, our Christian sympathy goes out to Cindy Scott and her family. Her brother Rick, who's been on our prayer list, passed away this last week on Monday, I believe. Betty Greeley is still in the hospital. She had her surgery. There was a little bit of a complication and some bleeding, but they've got that resolved. They're just keeping her for a few more days to be safe, and just for observation. And then finally, Don Caporel, who's, of course, out in Texas in the hospital, has had many complications, and it's a very, very difficult situation, and we need to pray for them both, for Don and for Claudia. Our call to worship is this. In the fullness of time, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth. To those who received Him, He gave the right to become children of God. Let us receive him anew, even today. Let us worship the Lord our God. Sending of your Son, our Lord, the Christ, the Anointed One, who's come into the world to save, whose coming we celebrate and remember this Christmas Advent season. Lord God, send forth your Spirit among us even now as we worship you this day. We might renew our faith, we might be encouraged and uplifted and inspired, and that we might again find the peace and the joy and the love of Christ, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I'm Tamar, the wife of Aaron. We keep a small inn on the outskirts of Bethlehem. Nothing fancy, mind you, just a clean room and a warm supper for the road-weary traveler. But it's a living. We have a dozen sheep as well. My son Itzhak spends his days in the fields with them, sometimes his nights too. He's a fine young man. And we have two cows, a few chickens, and a horse. The animals provide some food for our guests and transportation for my husband when he goes to Jerusalem for the holy days. I've never been religious myself. The inn keeps me really busy. And when Aram and Itzhak are gone, of course, I've got the animals to look after too. We keep a kosher kitchen, of course, for our guests. And why not? It's a simple thing to do. We're really busy this year. Those greedy overlords in Rome are holding a census so they can count all of their little minions here in Israel. But why should I complain? It's good for business. You know, there are times in the hustle and bustle of daily life that something grabs you and shakes you and cries out, "Pay attention! Life is more than just your own four walls." Maybe you're serving a meal or cleaning a room for a guest. At any rate, you are not expecting a jolt. The inn was full the other night when Aram answered a knock at our door. By chance, really, I passed by and glanced at the young man and his very pregnant wife. It was at that time that Aram was turning them away, and I was grabbed by that intangible urgency. I saw the pain in the girl's eyes, for one thing. Any woman knows that expression if she's ever carried children in her womb. I knew we could not turn away a woman ready to birth her child. But where could she go? Our inn was completely filled. We'd even given up our own beds to travelers. Every inn in Bethlehem would be the same. Well, you just don't turn people like that away. As Aram closed the door, I caught his sleeve and asked, "What about the stable, Aram? Couldn't they stay there? She needs shelter, and she needs it now." As he opened the door to catch them, I hurried to ready a lamp and to find some clothes, blankets, anything that she might use to swaddle the babe that would soon be born. I had never midwifed before that night, and I really didn't do much then. But a woman needs another woman close at times like that. So I stayed, made her comfortable, and helped to deliver her son. The birth of a child is always a precious moment. But there was magic in our stable that night. The smile of the new mother as she nursed her baby, it brought tears to my eyes. I found myself washed over by a sensation too powerful to contain. It was as if God's love for this room, for Bethlehem, for this mother, this child, and even for me, consumed all of us in this little building on that peaceful night. In that moment, I knew, in the depths of my soul, that God still loved me. Simple, heathen, little me. I was allowed to share in the life of a new baby. This was more than just the act of life renewing itself in my stable. Here, somehow, was the presence of God, reminding me that God never escapes us. Love never leaves us alone. And so now I light the candle of love.
Where evil is banished and
Jesus foretold. In the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph. Joseph was a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid. Mary, you have found favor with God. You will be with child and give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be, Mary?" asked the angel. "I am a virgin." And the angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child. In her old age, she who was said to be born barren is in her sixth month. Nothing is impossible with God." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May it be to me as you have said." And then the angel left her.
Thank you.
Thank you, choir. Thank you, Ryan. Thank you, Pat. Thank you all. Thank you, Lord God. Let's pray together. Well, Lord God, it is with great joy that we come together this day as we participate and share together in this service of worship and a celebration of your coming into the world in Jesus Christ. And so it is with gladness and anticipation in our hearts that we sing our songs, that we make our preparations, that we send our cards and give greetings and gifts to one another. To those whose lives have touched ours throughout the years. May the true Spirit of Christ touch our heart this year, we pray, each and every one of us. May we once again be open to receive Him and the gifts and the blessings that He offers us now and forever. Lord God, in the repeated cycle of the Christmas and Advent season, with all the nostalgic warm memories that we have and the present opportunities, we see the continuity of your love and your grace. We pray especially today for those who bear the burdens of sadness or sorrow or grief, for good times now past, for people in our lives now lost to us on this earth, and for tragic events that sometimes tear life apart. Lord God, as you came into a hurting world then, come into our hurting world now. Visit, we pray, with your comfort and your care, all those who are in special need. Stir up in us anew and afresh sense of love in your presence that is always with us, that abides with us, that came into the world to die for us and gives us life anew. And so as we celebrate the birth of Christ, may we be renewed in our understanding of the magnitude of his coming and what it means to us. Your grace and power to lift us to new heights of life and love. Increase our capacity to receive these gifts and to share them with others, that we might be messengers, that we might be gift givers, that we might be gracious bearers of your love into our world. We do pray for this world that hurts and is so racked with evil and disease and controversy. We pray for your peace on earth. We pray that your love would be made manifest even through us this Christmas season and forever and ever. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Thank you. Randy and I have been here Thursday for the rehearsal, Friday for the wedding, yesterday for the sing-along, and now today for worship. Go ahead and take the rest of the day off after service.
I was also here Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday.
Well, yeah, I know. Well, yeah. Likewise, but I'm just saying for performance sake. Not to get ready for them. But we did have this beautiful wedding here in the sanctuary on Friday, as I mentioned. This sanctuary is always so beautiful in its elegance and its simplicity. But it's even more beautiful at Christmas time, I think. And then to top it all off, we had this lovely wedding. The whole wedding party were just right off of Bride's Magazine or GQ or something. A beautiful bride and a handsome groom and all the attendants were just so nice. John, I really don't know how you managed to get such a beautiful daughter. But actually, I get asked the same question. And the answer is, pretty wives. As it turns out, pretty girls dig drummers. Who knew? Who knew? Thank the Lord. John and I even got to play a duet at the reception at the family's request, so that was fun. The wedding was smaller than originally intended because of COVID, but we still had the full complement of bridal party up here, the bride's side and the groom's side. And even though we didn't have a lot of guests in attendance in person, the family members were seated appropriately, the bride's side and the groom's side. And do you know why that is? The man escorts the woman on his left arm. It's so that his right hand, his sword hand, will be free to defend his lady from any threats. So, no extra charge, a little tip. But the reason I'm telling you all this about the bride's side and the groom's side is because the Bible does the same thing. The New Testament lessons that we've read today and are about to read talk about the bride's side from Luke about Mary. And what I'm going to read in just a moment talks about the groom's side in Matthew about Joseph. Listen to this word from the Lord, from Matthew chapter 1. Now the birth of Jesus took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child of the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered this, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary, your wife. For that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. And she will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and his name shall be called Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had borne a son. And he called his name Jesus. May God add his richest blessing to this, our reading of this holy word. Let us pray. Lord, again, we thank you for your word that comes to us. The word from Isaiah, that prophecy that was fulfilled, that word from Luke, the angel that spoke to Mary, and that word from Matthew that was spoken to Joseph. We pray now that your same Spirit would speak your word to us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, the sermon title today, if you look and pay attention to such things, is Mary and Joseph and You and Me. So, ladies first. So, we begin with the bride's side, with Mary. The scripture tells us a little bit about her, that she was of low estate. She was a virgin. She was betrothed to Joseph. She was a cousin of Elizabeth. Basically, she was a peasant girl, a lower class, certainly not a princess, not a priestess, not even a rabbi's daughter, just a plain girl, a small town girl, you could say. So the big question is, well, so what was it about Mary? Not what was it about Mary that Joseph would choose her to marry, but that God would choose her to bear his son to the world. Why Mary? What was it about her? The next passage in Luke, after where Brian left off, talks about that time when Elizabeth came and visited Mary. And Elizabeth said this: "Blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of that what was spoken from the Lord." That's what Elizabeth said about her cousin Mary. Blessed is she who believed. That's something we need to more fully understand as we consider, again, this familiar Christmas story. Blessed is she who believed. So let me ask you, what if she had not believed? What then? Or what if Mary just said, no. Thanks, but no thanks. There were plenty of good reasons for her to do that. She could have very easily deferred or ducked out. But think for a minute about what it must have been like for Mary. She's a very young teenage girl. She isn't married. She's only engaged to be married. An engagement, a betrothal that was like a marriage and as sacred as a marriage, but not consummated yet like a marriage. So this young teenage girl, engaged to be married, living in a small town, and you know how people talk in small towns. And what's more, she lives in a culture where sexual promiscuity is taken very seriously. So much so that it can possibly bring the death penalty. So you got the picture? So all of a sudden, out of nowhere, this angel comes and God calls her to become pregnant by the power of the Holy Spirit. God has found favor with her and God has selected her to be the mother of the Messiah,
to bear God's own life into the world. How wonderful! What a great honor! What a great privilege it would be! And what a great risk to consent. Mary, did you know? I mean, just imagine the rumors that are going to spread through this small town. Then word gets out that Mary is going to have a baby. You're what? Imagine what people will say. Imagine what her fiancé will say. Imagine what you would say. If your fiance, if your daughter, if your granddaughter comes to you and says, I'm pregnant, but it's not what you think. The power of the Lord overshadowed me. Yeah, right. Really? And I'm the king of England. Matthew tells us that when Joseph first found out that Mary was pregnant, he had a good mind to put her away. You see, there are plenty of good reasons for Mary to say no. Thanks, Lord, but no thanks. Not me. Choose someone else. Her reputation was at stake. Her marriage was at stake. But even her very life might be at stake. So we don't do Mary or the biblical record any favors when we overly romanticize this. The cost, the real cost and risk that she had to consider. But isn't it a remarkable thing about Mary and about Joseph and about God that it was all accomplished? And it came together. According to his plan. Oh, why me? Why couldn't God pick somebody else? Or why couldn't God just wait another year and then it wouldn't look so bad? See, there's a great temptation to say no to God when he chooses us. Or there's a great temptation to pray the world's most common prayer, my will be done, rather than the world's greatest prayer, thy will be done. But basically, that's what Mary said. Thy will be done. Behold, I am the handmaid of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word. That's what was so amazing about Mary. Here she's but a simple peasant girl, a handmaid, and she's open to the creative word of God, who is willing to work through her, even her. To do great things. Mary heard God's word and believed. She accepted God's plan for her life, and she bore God's love in her body and in her life. That love and that life of God incarnate in the flesh in the baby Jesus. See, Mary's true greatness is her faith awakened by God's call. Her faith and trust in God that despite all the obstacles and the potential problems that she'll face, she would obey God's word. Mary believed and she obeyed. She believed that even God could use little old her, and so she surrendered herself. Augustine said once a long time ago that Mary first conceived Christ in her heart before she conceived him in her womb. Mary said yes to God's call and claim upon her. And through that, the miracle of the incarnation took place, which is what we celebrate at Christmas. So, Mary was obedient to God's call and claim on her life, despite all the risks and the hardships. Okay, now it's the groom's side. Joseph also, in due time, would also have to face some really, really tough issues and decisions. First of all, he had to face one of the most shocking and heart-wrenching things that a man ever has to face. That his fiancée, that his beloved, is with child. And he knows darn well that he is not the father. So what's he supposed to think? What's he supposed to do? Guys, what would you do? I mean, really. Some of you remember that last summer on Father's Day, our son, Jeff, was up here, and we did a dialogue sermon back and forth, a father and son using the Lord's Prayer as a conversation, as a dialogue. And now that I think about it, since I had Brian up here earlier, maybe she and I should have done the same thing and had a dialogue about this particular situation, turning the clock back 50 years and facing a pregnancy out of the blue. How would we have handled it? What would we have said? Or maybe I'd bring two of you up here to do that. Maybe that would be interesting. Maybe it'd be dangerous. I don't know. Well, the scripture tells us that Joseph, being a decent man, is simply going to put her away quietly. Okay? In other words, he's not going to call her out publicly and make a spectacle of her. He's not going to go out and stand in the courtyard and say, "You two-bit, two-timing so-and-so." He's not going to have her stoned to death. He's simply, under the circumstances, going to try and do the right thing and end this engagement, this betrothal, quietly. But then he too receives a message from the Lord. A message that has never been spoken before then and has never been spoken since then. A unique word. That this child that his wife was to bear had been conceived by the Holy Spirit of God. That same Spirit of God that was God's agent of creation, when the universe was created out of nothing. So this is a piece of cake compared to that. Everything out of nothing compared to creating a life in a human womb. So Joseph also believed, and he obeyed. So there it is, the story. Both Mary and Joseph, bride side, groom side. Female, male. Both believed the Lord and obeyed. And that's where it comes down to us. That's the you and me part of the sermon. We've got Mary, we've got Joseph. What about you and what about me? Do we believe and obey? What's the old gospel song? Trust and obey, for there's no other way. Talking about faith and faithfulness. Do we think God is asking a lot of us? Asking too much compared to them? Maybe you're being called to do something that's risky or costly or difficult. What's our answer? Lord, let it be to me according to your word. Or maybe you're dealing with a relationship that isn't what it should be. Trust is broken. Communications are broken down with a spouse or with your children or your grandchildren, or somebody in your life is giving you trouble and heartache, and you're ready to cast them aside, even quietly. Well, maybe you should and maybe you shouldn't. I don't know. But first, we need to seek God's word and God's leading and pray the prayer, Lord, let it be to me according to your word. Let me do what is right in your sight. Let it be to me according to your word. Lord, I am but a servant, a handmaid. That's what Mary said. She bore Christ into the world. And Joseph agreed to keep Mary as his fiancée and then his wife, and then to raise Jesus in his own home as his own son. So how and when and where does God call you and me to bear Christ into the world? In our homes, in our community, in our world. Through the gifts that we give that reach out and bless others. Through our deeds of love and care and support for each other. Through words of witness to others about the good news of Jesus. How many have been an angel messenger of the gospel this week? When and where is God calling you to bear his love? You see, it may have begun with Mary and Joseph, but it doesn't end there. They're but models of faith for us. Models of faith and obedience. But even now with you and me, all who still hear and believe the word are blessed. Let me say that again. Even now, all who hear and believe the word are blessed. Blessed beyond measure, blessed beyond our comprehension. Hail, O favored ones, O graced ones, the Lord has found favor with you. The Lord is with you. Do not be afraid. Be blessed, the child who will be born. Child of promise into the world is the Savior. Receive him as Lord and Savior. What an awesome invitation and opportunity it is for us. Through God's grace in sending Jesus, through his life and his death and his resurrection, and through the continuing work of the Holy Spirit, we can know ourselves to be blessed. To continue to share in that life and that love. So, in a sense, we in the church, we the body of believers, are a bit like Mary. Having Christ formed in our midst. Christ alive and stirring and coming to life among us, like Mary. Or like Joseph, we never dreamed anything like this could happen. How could it happen? How does it still happen? It's simple. Because with God, nothing is impossible. Amen. Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.